I'd like to wish you a happy Sabbath. As you probably know, my pleasant task is to open the Word of God with you and talk about this very important pillar of our faith and of Scripture. And would you join me for just another moment as we bow our heads together and invite the Holy Spirit's presence? Father in heaven, right now in a very special sense, we pray that you would remove any distraction from our minds. Help us, Lord, during this holy time in this holy place to open your holy word and to understand the importance of this subject. Please bless as you've promised. Amen. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to the book of Revelation. Revelation chapter 14. And this is the first part of what is known as the three angel messages. Revelation 14, verse 6. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell upon the earth, to every nation, tongue, and tribe and people, saying with a loud voice, "Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made the heaven and the earth, the sea, and the springs of waters." As you read on through this chapter, chapter 14 of Revelation, a little later on is pictured Jesus coming in the clouds of heaven. And this tells us that just before the Lord comes, there's a message that goes to the world calling people back to the worship of their Creator. You know, this is a very important subject today, dealing with the Sabbath truth, because it's one that goes back to the very beginning. It has to do with love. It has to do with our relationship with the Lord. And by the way, time is the stuff that life is made of. If you look in your Bibles, in the book of Genesis, we're going to go back to the beginning. Genesis chapter 2. Right after these first 7 days, or 6 days of creation, then it adds a chapter. Everything was made on the first 6 days, but we have a seven-day week. What did God make on the seventh day? He made another 24-hour period of time. Why? He did not make anything in that day, but he made another day. And the world over, the atheist, including the believer, celebrates a seven-day week. Now, you know, you can look in the solar system and understand why all of these ancient civilizations of the world, they had calendars with approximately 30 days in it. That's because of the lunar cycle. That's where we get the word for month. It's from the word moon, because it takes that long for the moon to go through its cycle. So all of these ancient cultures, whatever their religions were, had a month with about the same number of days. And you can look at the different cultures of the world, and you can see something in the sun, moon, and stars that gives us a year with about 360 to 365 days, because there's something in the sky, in astronomy, it takes the earth 365 and one quarter days, we know now, to go completely around the sun. And of course, we've got a day with 24 hours, because it takes 24 hours for the earth to rotate one time on its axis. But why does the whole world celebrate a seven-day week? What in the sun, moon, and stars gives us a seven-day week? There's really nothing, except you find it here in the very beginning. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished and all the host of them. And on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because he rested from all his work which God created and made. Now, how blessed can something be? Think about the most blessed, holy thing you can think of. There's only a few things that are especially sanctified or blessed. And I'd ask it this way: can anything be more sanctified than what God sanctifies? Matter of fact, think of the most sanctified holy thing in the world, and could anybody make anything holier than God makes it. So when God makes something holy, it's as holy and sanctified as it can be. Why were we created? The Bible says we were created for His glory in Isaiah. We are created to worship God. Man finds his fulfillment and his greatest joy, like those angels in Isaiah 6, flanking the Almighty God and saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts." And in the very beginning of time, after God made man and He made everything for His happiness in the world, He made one more thing to complete His blessing, to complete His happiness, He made a period of time. You know, you do all of your living in time. Time is the stuff life is made of. You waste your time, you waste your life. And so when God made this period of time, He made it for a relationship with Him, because this was a day that was to be blessed and sanctified by His presence. You know, the Sabbath commandment, which you find, matter of fact, why don't we turn there real quick? Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Exodus, Exodus chapter 20, and this will start with verse 8. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days you should labor and do all of your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. In it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter or your manservant nor your maidservant, nor your cattle, nor the stranger who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and the earth and the sea and all that is in them, and He rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Now I've got just to share a little testimony with you here. My background is kind of a quilt, a kaleidoscope of different religious experiences. Pretty much raised an atheist, Jewish mother, Baptist father, became agnostic when my brother and I came along, sent us to Catholic school, and public school. We went to school that advertised atheism, actually, and so I was all over the place, had no real preference. 17 years old, living in a cave up in the mountains for a year and a half by myself, read the Bible, accepted the Lord, and began to go to church. Amen. Well, I'd never heard of Seventh-day Adventist, and so I went to the local churches, went to a number of evangelical churches and charismatic churches, and I studied with many different groups. I just wanted to know, what's the truth? And when I ran into this subject, I mean, it's right there in the second chapter of the Bible. God blessed the seventh day. And then you find it in the Ten Commandments. I was confused because I figured I hadn't read all the Bible yet. I thought there must be a scripture here. I just haven't run into it yet that now commands us to keep another day or tells us it doesn't matter anymore. And so I'd go to the different pastors where I was worshiping, lovely Christian people in many different churches. And I met some just wonderful people, and I know the Lord was working in their lives, but there was a lot of confusion out there. And I'd ask one of the pastors, say, "Brother, I'm reading about the Sabbath, and of course it's in the Ten Commandments, and why don't we keep the Sabbath?" And I got all these different answers, and none of them agreed. One pastor would say, "Well, we're not under the law now, Doug, we're under grace." I said, "Okay, well, what does that mean? Do we keep the Ten Commandments or do we break them?" And he said, "Well," he said, "we keep the spirit of the law." I said, "All right, let me understand that. What does that mean?" He says, "Well, you keep it in your heart. It's an attitude, it's not an action." I said, "All right, so for instance, the commandment says, don't commit adultery. So as long as I've got a good attitude about it, I can commit the act," right? And that didn't make any sense. And I would never murder anybody. You know, Jesus said, if you're angry with your brother without cause, you're guilty of murder. So if you've got the right action, is it possible to literally murder somebody if you've got the right spirit and you're keeping the spirit of the law? And in the Sabbath also, if you're keeping the spirit of the Sabbath, where Jesus says, come unto me and I will give you rest, would you be breaking the commandment so that you could keep the spirit? with every other commandment you might look at, if you're going to keep the spirit of that law, you will also be keeping the letter of the law. The spirit is not to substitute the letter of the law. The spirit is to fulfill the real reason for keeping the letter of the law. Well, let me ask you another question. What if you are reading the Ten Commandments and you don't have the right spirit? Should you keep them anyway? Yes. Well, let me switch commandments on you and you'll get the principle. I really feel like stealing. I got stealing in my heart. So I'm not keeping it for the right reason. Should I go ahead and steal? No, there's a lot of other good reasons not to steal. One of them is called the penitentiary. So maybe I'm thinking adulterous things in my heart, and I'm looking and lusting, and I shouldn't be doing that. Since I don't have the right attitude in my heart, I may as well just go ahead and do it. You should always keep the commandments, because it'll always be better for you to keep the commandments. You want to strive to keep them from the heart for the right reason, is what Jesus was saying, but you ought to keep them because God said to keep them. They're not called the 10 recommendations or the 10 great suggestions. I just came back from Argentina a few weeks ago, and I found out when you're driving down there that the lines in the road are just recommendations. So what is the Sabbath day? Oh, wait, I was going to tell you some of the other things that I heard as I was visiting with the different pastors. Some of them said, yes, Doug, we do still keep that, but it's now the first day of the week. And I said, well, where's the commandment to keep the first day of the week as the Sabbath? They said, well, we don't really have a commandment, but we do have a long-standing tradition. I said, oh, that's no good. Then one pastor told me, he said, we do it in honor of the resurrection. I said, that's beautiful. He said, now where is the commandment to keep a new Sabbath in honor of the resurrection? I said, well, there's no specific commandment. Actually, there is something we do in honor of the resurrection. It's called baptism. It's a symbol of death, burial, and resurrection. But when God made the Sabbath day, was it before or after sin? Before sin. So is it perfect? All of the other ceremonial and Jewish holidays and Sabbaths, they all came after sin, and they were nailed to the cross. They're of a whole different order. But the Sabbath of the weekly cycle is part of God's perfect plan, and it's to last forever. And so this is a truth that's being lost sight of. Now, I want to tell you one reason that I think this is very important for us to remember, and it matters in our day. The way I read my Bible, there was a time when the king of Babylon told everybody in his kingdom to worship this statue he had set up when he commanded. And if they didn't, they'd be killed. If they did not pray to his image, they would be killed. Does that have echoes of Revelation 13? And some who were in the crowd that day were devoted Jews that keep the commandments, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they said, you know, they're not the 10 suggestions of God, they're the 10 commandments. And that includes the second one that says, do not worship graven images. And someone probably said, you know, if you don't bow down, you guys are going to lose your job. You might take a decrease in pay. And what about, you know, your family you might need to support? And they said, you know, we're willing to not only lose our jobs, we're willing to lose our lives to obey God. And so when the order was given and the music played and everybody bowed down, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego did not compromise the commandments. Then you get to Daniel chapter 6, and the king makes a law that everybody should worship differently. Another one has to do with how you worship. And Daniel has to decide. There's a commandment that says, you shall not have other gods before me. That's the first commandment. And he decided, you know, I'm not even going to close my windows. I'm going to open my windows. I'm not going to pray to the king. I'm going to pray to my God. And I'm not only going to open my windows, I'm going to kneel so they can see I'm in a posture of prayer. And I'm going to pray towards Jerusalem just like I've always done. And I'm going to pray out loud to my God so they can hear me from the window. I'm not going to put my light under a bush. I'm going to let it shine. It wasn't going to be popular because he was going to be killed, thrown to the lions if he was caught breaking this government law. And then it tells us in Revelation chapter 13, in the last days, the beast power is going to compel everybody to worship a certain way or be killed. First, they can't buy or sell. Ultimately, they'll be killed. And it revolves around how you worship. It's interesting, in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve had two sons. God specified that in order to have their sin covered, it required blood sacrifice. That's why he covered them with robes of skin. That's why Jesus is called the Lamb that was slain from the foundation of the world. And Cain said, I don't want to worship exactly like God said. It seems messy to me. It's not going to be popular. It's going to be a lot more popular to bring fruits and vegetables, a lot more colorful, a lot more pleasant than a dying lamb and blood. I mean, that's hard to market. Said, so I know God will be satisfied. If I've worked hard for my garden, I'm going to offer what I've worked for. I'm going to worship the same God my way. And Abel pled with his brother and said, no, you need to worship God's way. And he said, who do you think you are telling me? You're my younger brother. And Abel said, well, I tried. Abel made his offering. Fire came down from God, accepted the offering of Abel. Cain took his zucchini and bananas, whatever it was, and put it on the... Actually, there were no bananas. You realize they were a hybrid. They didn't come along until much later. So... pineapple, whatever it was. He put it up there, and he waited and waited, and fruit flies came, but no fire. And he got so mad, his brother said, look, I told you, the only way that God's going to accept your worship is if you do it the way he says. And it so angered Cain, he persecuted and killed his brother over worshiping God. Could it be history is going to repeat itself in the last days? Does it matter how we worship? Does it matter if we keep God's holy day? Yes. Can we change it to another day if we want? What is the Sabbath? Well, of course, we read the commandment to you from Exodus 20, verse 8 through 11. It is a memorial of creation. It says, for in 6 days the Lord created the heaven and the earth. Do we need a memorial of creation today? Are people forgetting what our origins are? We're having problems even within Christian circles, and even some Christian schools have the audacity to tell young people that they have slowly evolved over millions of years from some processes of death and disorganization and turned into these marvelous creatures that are wonderfully made just by accident and biological burps and things that have happened. That's really an insult to God. Yeah. It also, of course, violates the commandments, violates the Word of God that makes it very clear that God created the world in 6 days. You know, the only reason people would come up with these other periods of time, and by the way, when it comes to evolution, the Achilles heel of evolution is their dating method. You take away their dating method and the whole thing crumbles. They've got to extrapolate this whole crazy notion of us slowly evolving over millions of years where you can't prove it. And otherwise, because there's no evidence of macroevolution anywhere in creation that they can demonstrate. And yet it's destroying the faith of young people. Number one group that commits suicide in North America is the youth. And I can tell you, from one that used to believe in evolution, I thought all the time about killing myself, because I said, if I just evolve from sludge, and if I'm turning back into fertilizer, and if there's no purpose in life, then why not get it over with? And so it's really contributing to the destruction of these young people. You've got to know where you've come from, you've got to know what you're doing here, and you've got to know where you're going to be secure. All of that is wrapped up in the Sabbath truth. It tells you where you've come from. It says that we are here to worship a holy God. And it says someday we're going to be with Him face to face, worshiping Him in His presence. So it's a memorial of creation. Furthermore, right there in the commandment, it says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. You notice God doesn't say, make it holy. He says, I've made it holy. I want you to keep it holy. Now, if you came to watch our house for us, because we were going to be on a mission trip, and I said, look, can you do me a favor and keep the plants alive? And she said, no problem. And after we leave, and you go in the house to water the plants, and they're all dead. They're just dried up, brittle plants. And you say, why did Doug and Karen say keep the plants alive if they're dead? You can only keep them alive if they are alive. Right. And we can only keep the Sabbath holy if it already is holy. How important is this? You know, it occurred to me one day. On the planet, you've got a country that sometimes is referred to as the Holy Land. What country is that? That's Israel. And in the Holy Land, you've got the holy city. Well, what city is that? So that's Jerusalem. It's not Tel Aviv, it's Jerusalem. And in the holy city, you've got the Holy Mount. What's that called? It's Mount Moriah or Mount Zion, basically the same mountain. And on the Holy Mount, you have the Holy Temple. And in the Holy Temple, you had the Holy Place. And then just beyond the Holy Place, you had the Holy of Holies, or the Most Holy Place. And in that, you had the Holy Ark, that golden box. And oh, people wish they could find that golden box. And that would be a great archaeological find. And in the Holy Box, you've got the Holy Law. And in the Holy Law, written by God's finger, there's only one commandment that begins with the word holy. Matter of fact, the word holy only appears one time. You know where it is? Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. So when you look at planet Earth, you've got the epicenter of holiness is found in the law of God in the Sabbath commandment. The longest of the Ten Commandments, the only commandment that begins with the word remember. I was doing a seminar one day talking about this subject, and there were a number of people from different persuasions that were attending, and one Sunday keeping pastor was there, a little worried about some of his flock that were also there, so he thought he better come and find out what they were hearing. And I was doing a presentation on the Bible Sabbath, and I could see, it was a small group, I could see his face, and his face was turning red and his ears were red, which was a real flag. And eventually he raised his hand. He said, Brother Doug, he says, you're putting these people under a yoke of bondage. I said, why do you say that, brother? It's a small group. Everyone knew each other, small town. He said, you're teaching them salvation by works, telling them to keep the law. And I said, brother, you tell me, do you believe God wants us to keep the Ten Commandments or break them? He said, we're not under the law. I said, well, does he want us to keep them or break them? He said, no, we don't need to keep them. And his church members looked at him like, you know, does that mean? I mean, you really think about it. Most churches have no problem with the Ten Commandments until you mention the Sabbath truth. I mean, if I stand up in most churches around town and say, honor your father and your mother and be faithful to your spouse and don't steal from your neighbor and only worship God, you'd hear amen, hallelujah, preach it, praise the Lord. They think that's great. And then you say, remember the Sabbath, and some of them would go, amen, but what day are you talking about? You say, keep the seventh day. Whoa, works, bondage. Why? That's inconsistent. That's what I went through. I said, I can't figure that out. And so this brother, he heard his church kind of groan. He said, well, we're supposed to keep 9 of them. He said, the others are all, they're all done away with and they're reinstituted in the New Testament. 9 of them are, but you don't find the Sabbath. Now that is a myth. That is not true. It is true there is one of the Ten Commandments you do not find literally restated in the New Testament. It's a commandment that says, thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Can you tell me where that is in the New Testament? It actually says in the New Testament, hallowed be thy name. Same principle. Right? But the Sabbath commandment is found many times in the New Testament. So I said to this pastor, I said, so brother, you're telling me the one commandment where God says remember is the one that everyone's supposed to forget. Does that make sense? He said, well, you're putting them under a bondage of works. I said, no, you are. I'm telling them to rest. You're telling them to work. Isn't that right? So it's very inconsistent. It doesn't make sense. And so it's a memorial of creation, among other things. It's the time when we nurture our relationship with God for quality time. You know, frequently, Karen, I travel a lot and I'm always busy, and Karen says, Doug, we need to spend more time together. And I said, I was home all day yesterday. She said, well, you were in your office. I said, well, I was home. She said, that's not what I'm talking about. I said, well, we ate dinner together. Yeah, but we weren't talking. She said, we need time together. And she's always talking about quality time. It's a different kind of time. And so you'll run into these people and say, well, Pastor Doug, you keep the seventh day holy, but I keep all 7 days holy. I worship God every day. That sounds very pious, but, you know, that's not what the commandment's talking about. Should we worship God 7 days a week?
Yes.
Yeah. But if you're keeping the Sabbath 7 days a week, you're not holy, you're lazy. Because it says that you're supposed to work 6 days. And if you're really working, you can get distracted with just, you know, the concentration on the work. But we're supposed to lay our work aside on Sabbath, not let it, that holy time, be encumbered with the worries and concerns of this life. And it's quality time with God. That's why the devil hates it. Because follow this. You can't get to heaven if you don't love God. Does everyone here agree with that?
Amen.
There'll be people in heaven that went to church on the wrong day.
Yes.
We all agree? Yes. I'm not condemning everybody that may not have this straight. There will be people in heaven that had too many wives.
Yes.
Not me, but there'll be other people. There'll be other people, because I'm a bachelor. But there will be others in heaven like that. Because God winks at these times of ignorance, right? Will there be anyone in heaven that doesn't love?
No.
So how do you learn to love God? How do you learn to love anyone? You've got to communicate with them. You talk to them and they talk to you. You spend time with them. You develop this love relationship. The more you love God, the better you'll obey God, including His law. He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. By the way, Jesus is quoting Moses when he says that. Moses said, I command you to love the Lord your God and keep his commandments. He says, love and keep his commandments. And by the way, the Sabbath is a great environment to learn to love God and to keep the commandments for the right reason. You might even start out keeping the Sabbath just because it's a commandment. Just because, you know, it's God's commandment and he's God. And in the process, you learn to do it for the right reason. I remember my grandparents married 72 years. And my grandmother and my grandfather, Jewish grandparents, they're very outspoken and frank. And she'll say right there, she says, I didn't love your grandfather when I married him. I just wanted to get out of the house. I was 16 years old. I couldn't stand my parents and my sisters. And so, yeah, I'll marry you. But that's back in the day when marriage meant something, you know. And then they'd say, and he never got upset when she said that because he knew what was coming next. He'd just smile. She says, we learn to love each other. Over time, together, we develop love with each other. And if you spend time with God, now I'll tell you, if my grandmother can learn to love my grandfather, I know we can learn to love God because he was really difficult. And God is a lot easier to love than Poppy. And so it's a time also, do we need physical rest?
Yeah.
It's also time, he says, that you might rest, that your animals, the farm animals could rest, and the stranger within your gates could rest. Are we living in a world that is coming apart at the seams from stress and too much work? Sabbath's a time you lay all those concerns aside and you rest in the Lord.
Holy day.
We've come to give you praise.
We've come to give you praise.
I think six of the principal reasons that people are hospitalized can be connected to stress. Everything from heart disease to cancer to you name it, lack of sleep and fatigue, it all can be stress related. The Sabbath is a sign of redemption. God tells us that it's a seal, Exodus 31:13. Verily my Sabbaths you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that you might know that I am the Lord that sanctifies you. If God made everything in 6 days and he can make a day holy, then he can make you holy. If God can create everything in 6 days, he can recreate your heart. Isn't that right? Amen. Every Sabbath day, we're not only remembering that he's the creator and he can recreate us, but it is a memorial that he can also make us holy and sanctify us. Hallow my Sabbaths, Exodus 20:20. Hallow my Sabbaths, and it'll be a sign between me and you, that you might know that I am the Lord your God. By the way, the mark of the beast, that word that's used there in Greek means the seal of the beast. And God also speaks there in Revelation about the seal of God. And those who are worshiping God and those who are holy, the Sabbath is a sign of that seal that they have in the middle of God's law. You've got the seal of God. It tells us its title. Every government seal had these characteristics. It's got the title, it's got the name, it's got the territory. You've got those three things in the presidential seal. You find that in the seals that the ancient kings put on their documents. In the law of God, in the Sabbath commandment, you've got the seal of God. Right there in the law of God, in that commandment that begins with the word holy, you've got the seal of God. And he said that we should keep it holy. The Sabbath is not just for Jews. Does Jesus say the Sabbath was made for Jews?
No.
Or does he say it was made for man?
Amen.
When did God make the Sabbath? When Jacob came along?
No.
When Abraham came along, or when Adam came along?
Adam.
He made Adam, and then he made the Sabbath for man, to be a blessing for man. You can also read in Isaiah 56, verse 6 and 7, also the sons of the stranger that joined themselves to the Lord, it's also for the stranger, to serve him, to love the name of the Lord, to be his servants, everyone that keeps the Sabbath from polluting it and takes hold of my covenant. Notice the connection between keeping the Sabbath and taking hold of that new covenant. By the way, you realize the new covenant is only made with Israel. For those of you that are New Testament Christians, and you say, I'm not under the old covenant, I'm under the new covenant. You know what that says? A new covenant I will make after those days, saith the Lord, with the house of Israel. The Bible we read is a Jewish book. You realize that. And so everyone that takes hold of the covenant, they're also going to be keeping the Sabbath day. Even them I'll bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. The Sabbath, by the way, is a time for corporate worship. And Even those among us who are Sabbath keepers need to hear this, because I run into people every now and then. They say, oh yeah, Pastor Doug, well, it's a day of rest, and so I'm just going to go out and hang out with the meadows and the trees today, and that's how I'm going to rest. And I'm not condemning those that might do that from time to time, but you can't keep doing that, because the Sabbath is all about a convocation. Leviticus chapter 23, it is a holy convocation. I mean, I can't imagine a person coming down from camping up in the woods by themselves, and you say, where were you? I was at a convention. How many came? Just me. I had a convention. That's what the word convocation is. It means a convening, an assembly. We are to corporately come together and worship God. You stay all by yourself in your worship, and you're going to be unhealthy spiritually. You become eccentric. The Bible tells us, let us not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, and all the more as you see the day approaching. We need to come together. Oh, Pastor Doug, there's some people in my church, and they're kind of cantankerous. And that's why you need to be with them, because you're learning to love when you're in a situation like that, right? We're a family. We need it. Not to mention it is one of the Ten Commandments. Some say, well, God gave it just to the Jewish nation. Well, you read there in the Bible, when the Lord led the children of Israel out of Egypt, before they ever got to Mount Sinai, where God spoke His law in Exodus 20, He writes it in Exodus 32. In Exodus 16, they went out to gather, look for manna on the Sabbath day, and God said, how long are you going to keep breaking my commandments? He hasn't even spoken the Ten Commandments yet, and they knew before they ever got to Mount Sinai, it was one of His commandments. So it wasn't just given to the Jews at Mount Sinai. It was made for mankind. They knew very well what it was. Manna fell from heaven 6 days a week. No manna fell on the Sabbath. They were to gather twice as much on Friday. Now, in case any of you are wondering, what day of the week is the Sabbath? Well, seventh day. Yeah, but what day is the seventh day? By the way, first time you hear a number mentioned three times in the Bible is in Genesis chapter 2, when it talks about God's holy day in the beginning of the Bible. It says the seventh day, the seventh day, the seventh day. Then you get to the end of the Bible, it identifies the antithesis, the beast, the counterfeit of Christ. His number is 666. It's the opposite. The number to help identify God's people is 777. Saturday, this is, by the way, Merriam-Webster Dictionary, seventh day of the week, Saturday. Sunday, Merriam-Webster, first day of the week. You look at any normal calendar, it'll be very clear. Some calendars try and do it towards a work week, and they seem to start with Saturday and they end with Sunday, but that's just some printer that does that. Any encyclopedia will tell you that. Oh, but Pastor Doug, we don't really know what day is the Bible Sabbath anymore, because they've changed the calendar. And it is true that the calendar has been adjusted several times in history, but this is a common myth. There's not an ounce of truth to it. No matter what change is made to the calendar, it never affects the weekly cycle. It might affect your birthday, but it doesn't affect the birthday of the world. Because from the time of Adam to the present day, every Sabbath has been 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And so whenever they've adjusted the calendar, it never affected the days of the week. People get confused because they see the days of the week on a calendar and they think they're connected. They're totally two complete, distinct, separate cycles of time. Changing the calendar never affects the weekly cycle. It doesn't need to. Some of our evangelists have written to the Greenwich Observatory in Greenwich, England, and the U.S. Naval Observatory, and they've asked them, has there been any change in the calendar in recorded history that affects the weekly cycle? And they consistently write back and say, why would you ask a question like that? They don't affect each other. There has been no change to the calendar that affects the continuity of the weekly cycle as far back as we can go in recorded history. There's no question about it. You might be thinking, well, what happened? Oh, it was changed in history hundreds of years after Christ. Principally, as Constantine established Sunday as a day of worship in 321 AD, the Edict of Milan. And it began to be adopted by the church to be more popular, to try and reach more of the pagans. They compromised. They said, we'll keep both days as a while. For a while, you know, the devil's very insidious. And gradually, being Jewish was very unpopular in Rome during that time. to distance themselves from the Jew, they ultimately, and it didn't happen right away, it happened over hundreds of years, they abandoned the seventh-day Sabbath, they embraced the Roman day of the sun, and they started making philosophical rationalizations about why you should do it on the first day of the week. Now, I don't want to insult anybody, but there is more evidence for the Sabbath being on the seventh day of the week than virtually any other Bible teaching. I personally had no choice but to be a Sabbath-keeping Christian if I wanted to be a Bible Christian. Amen. A person has to go through the most amazing, mind-bending rationalizations. You've got to absolutely torture your logic to come up with the idea that this one commandment that begins with the word remember is the one we're supposed to forget that God wanted us to change. The longest of the commandment, the one commandment that says holy, it talks about worship. The whole final battle revolves around worship, and this is the one we're supposed to forget. Sounds extremely suspicious to me. Matter of fact, in 108 languages of the world, seventh day of the week, Spanish, sabado, Russian, subota, Micronesian, sabbat. It just goes on and on and on. And of course, we know that this day begins at sundown. Did Jesus keep the Sabbath? What is a Christian? Christian's a follower of Christ. What was Jesus' habit? Mark 6:2. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue. Luke 4:16. And he came to Nazareth, where he'd been brought up, and as his custom was, he went into the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read the scriptures. We know he read the scriptures. It even tells us what scripture he read on one occasion. Jesus went to the church every Sabbath day, and he read the Bible, and he studied, and he taught. He kept it. Oh, Pastor Doug, doesn't it say they accused Jesus of breaking the Sabbath? That's right. His enemies accused him of breaking the Sabbath. His enemies also accused him of being a drunk, a glutton, and demon-possessed Samaritan. So if you're going to go along with what his enemies accused him of doing, they accused him of all kinds of things. They said he deceives the people, too. And so some people have said, well, he broke the Sabbath. No, he didn't. He showed them how to keep it correctly. Jesus, looking down at the end of time, in Matthew 24, where he foretells his second coming, he says, pray that your flight be not in the winter, neither on the Sabbath day. Why does he say that to God's people, speaking about the end of time? Because he knew they would still be Sabbath-keeping Christians back then. And there may be a time when we need to flee. When he says, you see the abomination of desolation stand in the holy place, let those that be in Judea flee into the mountains. There's a day coming when those who want to keep all of the commandments of God are going to be persecuted for their faith. The Bible tells us Jesus kept the Sabbath. The early Christians kept the Sabbath. Acts 17:1, it says, when they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews, then Paul, as his custom was, he went into them, and for three Sabbaths, he reasoned to them from the Scriptures. And then Acts 13, it says, the Gentiles begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. They're talking not just to Jews, they're talking to the Gentiles. On what day? On the Sabbath. On the next Sabbath, almost the whole city came together to hear the word of God. That was Acts 13:44. Acts 16:13. And on the Sabbath day, we went out of the city to the riverside where prayer was customarily made, and we sat down and spoke to the women that resorted thither. That's written by Luke. Was Luke a Jew or a Gentile? Why doesn't Luke say, and on the Jewish Sabbath they got together? He states it as it was just understood by all the believers back then. He's writing to Theophilus, and he's saying, this is what we did, and on the Sabbath, and he doesn't have to explain to him what the Sabbath is, because every Christian knew it's one of the Ten Commandments. It's Christianity 101, that day of worship. There's not even the hint here that they had changed it. You know, the Bible does foretell in the last days the beast power would think to change times and laws, and there's only one of God's commandments that is both a time and a law. And you know what also makes me marvel, friends, is that in Luke 23, because the Sabbath was so important to the disciples, they would not even finish embalming the body of Jesus. That's verse 56. It says, they prepared spices and fragrant oils, and they rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment. The commandment, not the Jewish law. You know, can you imagine? It was so important to them. Their hearts are broken. They've spent 3.5 years following Jesus. They love him. They want to give him an honorable treatment. The sun is going down. They realize they're going to run out of time. It would have been so easy for most of us would have said, well, the ox is in the ditch. Let's at least finish embalming his body. But they said, no, Jesus would not be pleased if we did this. And rather than disappoint him, they said, we'll come back and finish later. The Sabbath's coming. So did they ever get the slightest notion from Jesus that it didn't matter to him? Even this labor of love was postponed because the early church recognized how Jesus felt about this. Is it still valid today, friends? Does the Lord care? It's easier for heaven and earth to pass away than for one tittle of the law to fail. God tells us that His word is not going to change. The Bible begins telling us the seventh day. Remember that day. A whole day to be kept is holy. Then you get to the end of the Bible. In Revelation chapter 22, verse 14, it says, blessed. Is there a blessing in the Sabbath?
Yes.
Revelation 14, 22, blessed are those who do His commandments. One commandment especially pronounces a blessing upon it, that they might have a right to the tree of life and enter through the gates of the city. So from cover to cover in the Bible, God is very clear that He wants us to be blessed. He wants us to be happy. You're only going to find that happiness in a relationship with Him.
Right.
You know, I did a lot of traveling yesterday to get here. Landed yesterday. It was a little late for me to meet with you people then, but I was in Sacramento, big city, and Seattle, St. Louis. Stopped a couple places on the road, and I looked at a lot of people. I was by myself, so I look at people. And in case you didn't know it, people aren't happy. People are not satisfied. Everywhere I looked, I remember I was on the plane, and I got up and I walked the length of the plane to use the facilities, and on my way back, I kind of looked over everyone's shoulder. It was a daytime flight. People are awake. And everybody seems so restless. And they're, you know, they're working and they're trying to read these love novels and find some answer, or they're watching a variety of movies. I'd be embarrassed if I were a lot of these people to have people on the right and left of me watching the movies that they were watching on their laptops and stuff. And they're just looking for something. People are empty. They're unhappy. I stopped, got a Subway sandwich, saw this man in there. Looked so unhappy. He was binging on sweets and reading some romance novel, and I just thought, he's looking for rest. He's looking for peace. He's looking for purpose. The great invitation, Matthew chapter 11, Christ said, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Every Sabbath day we're remembering the rest. Have you found your rest in Him?
Amen.
He wants you to enjoy that day of blessed rest. How many of you would like to say, Lord, by Your grace, I want that experience also?
Let the world Inspired by the Bible Experience. the book of 1 Kings. When King David was very old, he could not keep warm even when they put covers over him. So his attendants said to him,
"Let us look for a young virgin to serve the king and take care of him. She can lie beside him so that our lord the king may keep warm."
Then they searched throughout Israel for a beautiful girl and found Abishag, a Shunammite, and brought her to the king. The girl was very beautiful. She took care of the king and waited on him. But the king had no sexual relations with her. Now Adonijah, whose mother was Haggith, put himself forward and said,
"I will be king."
So he got chariots and horses ready, with 50 men to run ahead of him. His father had never rebuked him by asking, "Why do you behave as you do?" He was also very handsome and was born next after Absalom. Adonijah conferred with Joab, son of Zeruiah, and with Abiathar the priest, and they gave him their support. But Zadok the priest, Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, Nathan the prophet, Shimei, and Rei, and David's special guard did not join Adonijah. Adonijah then sacrificed sheep, cattle, and fattened calves at the stone of Zoheleth near INRO. He invited all his brothers, the king's sons, and all the royal officials of Judah, but he did not invite Nathan the prophet, or Benaiah, or the special guard, or his brother Solomon. Then Nathan asked Bathsheba, Solomon's mother,
"Have you not heard that Adonijah, the son of Haggith, has become king, and our lord David knows nothing about it? Now then, let me advise you how you can save your own life and the life of your son Solomon. Go into King David and say to him, 'My lord the king, did you not swear to me, your servant, 'Surely Solomon your son shall be king after me, and he will sit on my throne?' Why then has Adonijah become king? While you are still there talking to the king, I will come in and add my word to what you have said."
So Bathsheba went to see the aged king in his room, where Abishag the Shunammite was attending him. Bathsheba bowed down, prostrating herself before the king.
"What is it you want?"
the king asked. She said to him,
"My lord, you yourself swore to me, your servant, by the Lord your God, 'Solomon your son shall be king after me, and he will sit on my throne.' But now Adonijah has become king, and you, my lord the king, do not know about it. He has sacrificed great numbers of cattle, fattened calves, and sheep, and has invited all the king's sons, Abiathar the priest, and Joab the commander of the army, but he has not invited Solomon, your servant. My lord the king, the eyes of all Israel are on you, to learn from you who will sit on the throne of my lord the king after him. Otherwise, as soon as my lord the king is laid to rest with his ancestors, I and my son Solomon will be treated as criminals."
While she was still speaking with the king, Nathan the prophet arrived, and the king was told,
"Nathan the prophet is here."
So he went before the king and bowed with his face to the ground. Nathan said,
"Have you, my lord the king, declared that Adonijah shall be king after you, and that he will sit on your throne? Today he has gone down and sacrificed great numbers of cattle, fattened calves, and sheep. He has invited all the king's sons, the commanders of the army, and Abiathar the priest. Right now they are eating and drinking with him and saying, 'Long live King Adonijah.' But me, your servant, and Zadok the priest, and Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, and your servant Solomon he did not invite. Is this something my lord the king has done without letting his servants know who should sit on the throne of my lord the king after him?"
Then King David said,
"Call in Bathsheba."
So she came into the king's presence and stood before him. The king then took an oath,
"As surely as the Lord lives, who has delivered me out of every trouble. I will surely carry out this very day what I swore to you by the Lord, the God of Israel. Solomon, your son, shall be king after me, and he will sit on my throne in my place.
Then Bathsheba bowed down with her face to the ground, prostrating herself before the king, and said,
"May my lord King David live forever."
King David said,
"Call in Zadok the priest, Nathan the prophet, and Benaiah, son of Jehoiada."
When they came before the king, he said to them,
"Take your lord's servants with you, and have Solomon, my son, mount my own mule, and take him down to Gihon. There have Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet anoint him king over Israel. Blow the trumpet and shout, 'Long live King Solomon!' Then you are to go up with him, and he is to come and sit on my throne and reign in my place. I have appointed him ruler over Israel and Judah."
Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, answered the king,
"Amen. May the Lord, the God of my lord the king, so declare it. As the Lord was with my lord the king, so may he be with Solomon to make his throne even greater than the throne of my lord King David."
So Zadok the priest, Nathan the prophet, Benaiah son of Jehoiada, the Kerethites and the Pelethites went down and had Solomon mount King David's mule, and they escorted him to Gihon. Zadok the priest took the horn of oil from the sacred tent and anointed Solomon. Then they sounded the trumpet, and all the people shouted,
"Long live King Solomon!"
And all the people went up after him, playing pipes and rejoicing greatly, so that the ground shook with the sound. Adonijah and all the guests who were with him heard it as they were finishing their feast. On hearing the sound of the trumpet, Joab asked,
"What's the meaning of all the noise in the city?"
Even as he was speaking, Jonathan, son of Abiathar, the priest, arrived. Adonijah said,
"Come in. A worthy man like you must be bringing good news."
"Not at all,"
Jonathan answered.
"Our lord, King David, has made Solomon king. The king has sent with him Zadok the priest, Nathan the prophet, Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, the Kerethites and the Pelethites, and they have put him on the king's mule. And Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet have anointed him king of Gihon. From there they have gone up cheering, and the city resounds with it. That's the noise you hear. Moreover, Solomon has taken his seat on the royal throne. Also, the royal officials have come up to congratulate our lord King David, saying, 'May your God make Solomon's name more famous than yours and his throne greater than yours.'" And the king bowed in worship on his bed and said, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, who has allowed my eyes to see a successor on my throne today."
At this, all Adonijah's guests rose in alarm and dispersed. But Adonijah, in fear of Solomon, went and took hold of the horns of the altar. Then Solomon was told,
"Adonijah is afraid of King Solomon and is clinging to the horns of the altar.
He says, 'Let King Solomon swear to me today that he will not put his servant to death with the sword.'"
Solomon replied,
"If he shows himself to be worthy, not a hair of his head will fall to the ground. But if evil is found in him, he will die."
Then King Solomon sent men, and they brought him down from the altar. And Adonijah came and bowed down to King Solomon. And Solomon said,
"Go to your home."
When the time drew near for David to die, he gave a charge to Solomon, his son.
"I am about to go the way of all the earth," he said. "So be strong, act like a man, and observe what the Lord your God requires. Walk in obedience to him, and keep his decrees and commands, his laws and regulations, as written in the law of Moses. Do this so that you may prosper in all you do and wherever you go, and that the Lord may keep his promise to me. If your descendants watch how they live, and if they walk faithfully before me with all their heart and soul, you will never fail to have a successor on the throne of Israel. Now you yourself know what Joab, son of Zeruiah, did to me. What he did to the two commanders of Israel's armies, Abner, son of Ner, and Amasa, son of Jether. He killed them, shedding their blood in peacetime as if in battle. And with that blood, he stained the belt around his waist and the sandals on his feet. Deal with him according to your wisdom, but do not let his gray head go down to the grave in peace. But show kindness to the sons of Barzillai of Gilead, and let them be among those who eat at your table. They stood by me when I fled from your brother Absalom. And remember, you have with you Shimei, son of Gera, the Benjamite from Bahurim, who called down bitter curses on me the day I went to Mahanaim. When he came down to meet me at the Jordan, I swore to him by the Lord, I will not put you to death by the sword. But now, do not consider him innocent. You are a man of wisdom. You will know what to do to him. Bring his gray head down to the grave in blood.
Then David rested with his ancestors and was buried in the city of David. He had reigned 40 years over Israel, 7 years in Hebron, and 33 in Jerusalem. So Solomon sat on the throne of his father David, and his rule was firmly established. Now Adonijah, the son of Haggith, went to Bathsheba, Solomon's mother. Bathsheba asked him,
"Do you come peacefully?"
He answered,
"Yes, peacefully."
Then he added,
"I have something to say to you."
"You may say it,"
she replied.
"As you know,"
he said,
"the kingdom was mine. All Israel looked to me as their king. But things changed, and the kingdom has gone to my brother, for it has come to him from the Lord. Now, I have one request to make of you. Do not refuse me."
"You may make it,"
she said. So he continued,
"Please, ask King Solomon, he will not refuse you, to give me Abishag the Shunammite as my wife."
"Very well,"
Bathsheba replied.
"I will speak to the king for you."
When Bathsheba went to King Solomon to speak to him for Adonijah, the king stood up to meet her, bowed down to her, and sat down on his throne. He had a throne brought for the king's mother, and she sat down at his right hand.
"I have one small request to make of you,"
she said.
"Do not refuse me."
The king replied,
"Make it, my mother. I will not refuse you."
So she said,
"Let Abishag the Shunammite be given in marriage to your brother Adonijah."
King Solomon answered his mother,
"Why do you request Abishag the Shunammite for Adonijah? You might as well request the kingdom for him. After all, he is my older brother. Yes, for him, and for Abiathar the priest, and Joab son of Zeruiah."
Then King Solomon swore by the Lord,
"May God deal with me, be it ever so severely, if Adonijah does not pay with his life for this request. And now, as surely as the Lord lives, he who has established me securely on the throne of my father David, and has founded a dynasty for me as he promised, Adonijah shall be put to death today."
So King Solomon gave orders to Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, and he struck down Adonijah, and he died. To Abiathar the priest, the king said,
"Go back to your fields in Anathoth. You deserve to die. But I will not put you to death now, because you carried the ark of the sovereign Lord before my father David, and shared all my father's hardships."
So Solomon removed Abiathar from the priesthood of the Lord, fulfilling the word the Lord had spoken at Shiloh about the house of Eli. When the news reached Joab, who had conspired with Adonijah, though not with Absalom, he fled to the tent of the Lord and took hold of the horns of the altar. King Solomon was told that Joab had fled to the tent of the Lord and was beside the altar. Then Solomon ordered Benaiah, son of Jehoiada,
"Go, strike him down."
So Benaiah entered the tent of the Lord and said to Joab,
"The king says, come out."
But he answered,
"No, I will die here."
Benaiah reported to the king,
"This is how Joab answered me."
Then the king commanded Benaiah,
"Do as he says. Strike him down and bury him, and so clear me and my family line of the guilt of the innocent blood that Joab shed. The Lord will repay him for the blood he shed, because without my father David knowing it, he attacked two men and killed them with the sword. Both of them, Abner, son of Ner, commander of Israel's army, and Amasa, son of Jether, commander of Judah's army, were better men and more upright than he. May the guilt of their blood rest on the head of Joab and his descendants forever. But on David and his descendants, his house and his throne, may there be the Lord's peace forever."
So Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, went up and struck down Joab and killed him, and he was buried at his home out in the country. The king put Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, over the army in Joab's position, and replaced Abiathar with Zadok the priest. Then the king sent for Shimei and said to him,
"Build yourself a house in Jerusalem and live there, but do not go anywhere else. The day you leave and cross the Kidron Valley, you can be sure you will die. Your blood will be on your own head."
Shimei answered the king,
"What you say is good. Your servant will do as my lord the king has said."
And Shimei stayed in Jerusalem for a long time. But 3 years later, two of Shimei's slaves ran off to Achish, son of Maokah, king of Gath, and Shimei was told,
"Your slaves are in Gath."
At this, he saddled his donkey and went to Achish at Gath in search of his slaves. So Shimei went away and brought the slaves back from Gath. When Solomon was told that Shimei had gone from Jerusalem to Gath and had returned, the king summoned Shimei and said to him,
"Did I not make you swear by the Lord and warn you on the day you leave to go anywhere else, you can be sure you will die? At that time you said to me, 'What you say is good, I will obey.' Why then did you not keep your oath to the Lord and obey the command I gave you?"
The king also said to Shimei,
"You know in your heart all the wrong you did to my father David. Now the Lord will repay you for your wrongdoing. But King Solomon will be blessed, and David's throne will remain secure before the Lord forever."
Then the king gave the order to Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, and he went out and struck Shimei down, and he died. The kingdom was now established in Solomon's hands. Solomon made an alliance with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and married his daughter. He brought her to the city of David until he finished building his palace and the temple of the Lord and the wall around Jerusalem. The people, however, were still sacrificing at the high places because a temple had not yet been built for the name of the Lord. Solomon showed his love for the Lord by walking according to the instructions given him by his father David, except that he offered sacrifices and burned incense on the high places. The king went to Gibeon to offer sacrifices, for that was the most important high place, and Solomon offered 1,000 burnt offerings on that altar. At Gibeon, the Lord appeared to Solomon during the night in a dream, and God said,
"Ask for whatever you want me to give you."
Solomon answered,
"You have shown great kindness to your servant, my father David, because he was faithful to you and righteous and upright in heart. You have continued this great kindness to him and have given him a son to sit on his throne this very day. Now, Lord my God, you have made your servant king in place of my father David, but I am only a little child and do not know how to carry out my duties. Your servant is here among the people you have chosen, a
great people, too numerous to count or number. So give your servant a discerning heart to govern your people and to distinguish between right and wrong. For who is able to govern this great people of yours?
The Lord was pleased that Solomon had asked for this. So God said to him,
Since you have asked for this, and not for long life or wealth for yourself, nor have asked for the death of your enemies, but for discernment in administering justice, I will do what you have asked. I will give you a wise and discerning heart, so that there will never have been anyone like you, nor will there ever be. Moreover, I will give you what you have not asked for, both wealth and honor, so that in your lifetime you will have no equal among kings. And if you walk in obedience to me and keep my decrees and commands, as David your father did, I will give you a long life.
Then Solomon awoke, and he realized it had been a dream. He returned to Jerusalem, stood before the Ark of the Lord's Covenant, and sacrificed burnt offerings and fellowship offerings. Then he gave a feast for all his court. Now two prostitutes came to the king and stood before him. One of them said,
Pardon me, my lord. This woman and I live in the same house, and I had a baby while she was there with me. The third day after my child was born, this woman also had a baby. We were alone. There was no one in the house but the two of us. During the night, this woman's son died because she lay on him. So she got up in the middle of the night and took my son from my side while I, your servant, was asleep. She put him by her breast and put her dead son by my breast. The next morning, I got up to nurse my son, and he was dead. But when I looked at him closely in the morning light, I saw that it wasn't the son I had born.
The other woman said,
No! The living one is my son. The dead one is yours.
But the first insisted,
No! The dead one is yours. The living one is mine.
And so they argued before the king. The king said,
This one says, My son is alive and your son is dead. While that one says, No, your son is dead and mine is alive.
Then the king said,
Bring me a sword.
So they brought a sword for the king. He then gave an order.
Cut the living child in two. Give half to one and half to the other.
The woman whose son was alive was deeply moved out of love for her son and said to the king,
Please, my lord, give her the living baby. Don't kill him.
But the other said,
Neither I nor you shall have him. Cut him in two.
Then the king gave his ruling.
Ah, give the living baby to the first woman. Do not kill him. She is his mother.
When all Israel heard the verdict the king had given, they held the king in awe because they saw that he had wisdom from God to administer justice. So King Solomon ruled over all Israel, and these were his chief officials: Azariah, son of Zadok the priest; Elohoreph and Ahijah, son of Shisha, secretaries; Jehoshaphat, son of Ahilud, recorder; Benaiah, son of Jehoiada, commander-in-chief; Zadok and Abiathar, priests; Azariah, son of Nathan, in charge of the district governors; Zabad, son of Nathan, a priest and advisor to the king; Ahishar, palace administrator; Adoniram, son of Abda, in charge of forced labor. Solomon had 12 district governors over all Israel who supplied provisions for the king and the royal household. Each one had to provide supplies for 1 month in the year. These are their names: Ben-Hur in the hill country of Ephraim, Ben-Dekah in Makaz, Shaubim, Beth-Shemesh, and Elon Beth-Hanan; Ben-Hesed in Arubah; Soko and all the land of Hefer were his. Ben Abinadab in Naphath-Dor. He was married to Tapheth, daughter of Solomon. Beunah, son of Ahilud, in Taanach and Megiddo, and in all Beth-Shan, next to Zarethan, below Jezreel, from Beth-Shan to Abel-Meholah, across to Jokmeam. Ben-Geber in Ramoth-Gilead. The settlements of Jair, son of Manasseh, in Gilead were his, as well as the region of Argob in Bashan, and its 60 large walled cities with bronze gate bars. Ahinadab, son of Iddo, in Mahunaim. Ahimaaz in Naphtali. He had married Basemath, daughter of Solomon. Beunah, son of Hushai, in Asher and in Eleth. Jehoshaphat, son of Perua, in Issachar. Shimei, son of Elah, in Benjamin. Geber, son of Uri, in Gilead, the country of Sihon, king of the Amorites, and the country of Og, king of Bashan. He was the only governor over the district. The people of Judah and Israel were as numerous as the sand on the seashore. They ate, they drank, and they were happy. And Solomon ruled over all the kingdoms from the Euphrates River to the land of the Philistines, as far as the border of Egypt. These countries brought tribute and were Solomon's subjects all his life. Solomon's daily provisions were 30 cores of the finest flour and 60 cores of meal, 10 head of stall-fed cattle, 20 of pasture-fed cattle, and 100 sheep and goats, as well as deer, gazelles, roebucks, and choice fowl. For he ruled over all the kingdoms west of the Euphrates River, from Tifsa to Gaza, and had peace on all sides. During Solomon's lifetime, Judah and Israel from Dan to Beersheba lived in safety, everyone under their own vine and fig tree. Solomon had 4,000 stalls for chariot horses and 12,000 horses. The district governors, each in his month, supplied provisions for King Solomon and all who came to the king's table. They saw to it that nothing was lacking. They also brought to the proper place their quotas of barley and straw for the chariot horses and the other horses. God gave Solomon wisdom and very great insight and a breadth of understanding as measureless as the sand on the seashore. Solomon's wisdom was greater than the wisdom of all the people of the East and greater than all the wisdom of Egypt. He was wiser than anyone else, including even the Ezrahite, wiser than Heman, Chalcol, and Darda, the sons of Mahol, and his fame spread to all the surrounding nations. He spoke 3,000 proverbs, and his songs numbered 1,005. He spoke about plant life, from the cedar of Lebanon to the hyssop that grows out of walls. He also spoke about animals and birds, reptiles and fish. From all nations, people came to listen to Solomon's wisdom, sent by all the kings of the world who had heard of his wisdom. When Hiram, king of Tyre, heard that Solomon had been anointed king to succeed his father David, he sent his envoys to Solomon because he had always been on friendly terms with David. Solomon sent back this message to Hiram.
You know that because of the wars waged against my father David from all sides, he could not build a temple for the name of the Lord his God until the Lord put his enemies under his feet. But now the Lord my God has given me rest on every side, and there is no adversary or disaster. I intend, therefore, to build a temple for the name of the Lord my God, as the Lord told my father David when he said, "Your son, whom I will put on the throne in your place, will build the temple for my name." So give orders that cedars of Lebanon be cut for me. My men will work with yours, and I will pay you for your men whatever wages you set. You know that we have no one so skilled in felling timber as the Sidonians.
When Hiram heard Solomon's message, he was greatly pleased and said,
"Praise be to the Lord today, for he has given David a wise son to rule over this great nation."
So Hiram sent word to Solomon,
"I have received the message you sent me, and will do all you want in providing the cedar and juniper logs. My men will haul them down from Lebanon to the Mediterranean Sea, and I will float them as rafts by the sea to the place you specify. There I will separate them, and you can take them away. And you are to grant my wish by providing food for my royal household.
In this way, Hiram kept Solomon supplied with all the cedar and juniper logs he wanted. And Solomon gave Hiram 20,000 cores of wheat as food for his household, in addition to 20,000 baths of pressed olive oil. Solomon continued to do this for Hiram year after year. The Lord gave Solomon wisdom, just as he had promised him. There were peaceful relations between Hiram and Solomon, and the two of them made a treaty. King Solomon conscripted laborers from all Israel, 30,000 men. He sent them off to Lebanon in shifts of 10,000 a month, so that they spent 1 month in Lebanon and 2 months at home. Adoniram was in charge of the forced labor. Solomon had 70,000 carriers and 80,000 stone cutters in the hills, as well as 3,300 overseers who supervised the project and directed the work. At the king's command, they removed from the quarry large blocks of high-grade stone to provide a foundation of dressed stone for the temple. The skilled workers of Solomon and Hiram and those from Byblos cut and prepared the timber and stone for the building of the temple. In the 480th year after the Israelites came out of Egypt, in the fourth year of Solomon's reign over Israel, in the month of Ziv, the second month, he began to build the temple of the Lord. The temple that King Solomon built for the Lord was 60 cubits long, 20 wide, and 30 high. The portico at the front of the main hall of the temple extended the width of the temple, that is, 20 cubits, and projected 10 cubits from the front of the temple. He made narrow windows high up in the temple walls. Against the walls of the main hall and inner sanctuary, he built a structure around the building in which there were side rooms. The lowest floor was 5 cubits wide, the middle floor 6 cubits, and the third floor 7. He made offset ledges around the outside of the temple so that nothing would be inserted into the temple walls. In building the temple, only blocks dressed at the quarry were used, and no hammer, chisel, or any other iron tool was heard at the temple site while it was being built. The entrance to the lowest floor was on the south side of the temple. A stairway led up to the middle level and from there to the third. So he built the temple and completed it, roofing it with beams and cedar planks. And he built the side rooms all along the temple. The height of each was 5 cubits, and they were attached to the temple by beams of cedar. The word of the Lord came to Solomon.
As for this temple you are building, if you follow my decrees, observe my laws, and keep all my commands and obey them, I will fulfill through you the promise I gave to David your father, and I will live among the Israelites and will not abandon my people Israel.
So Solomon built the temple and completed it. He lined its interior walls with cedar boards, paneling them from the floor of the temple to the ceiling, and covered the floor of the temple with planks of juniper. He partitioned off 20 cubits at the rear of the temple with cedar boards from floor to ceiling to form within the temple an inner sanctuary, the most holy place. The main hall in front of this room was 40 cubits long. The inside of the temple was cedar, carved with gourds and open flowers. Everything was cedar. No stone was to be seen. He prepared the inner sanctuary within the temple to set the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord there. The inner sanctuary was 20 cubits long, 20 wide, and 20 high. He overlaid the inside with pure gold, and he also overlaid the altar of cedar. Solomon covered the inside of the temple with pure gold, and he extended gold chains across the front of the inner sanctuary, which was overlaid with gold. So he overlaid the whole interior with gold. He also overlaid with gold the altar that belonged to the inner sanctuary. For the inner sanctuary, he made a pair of cherubim out of olive wood, each 10 cubits high. One wing of the first cherub was 5 cubits long, and the other wing 5 cubits, 10 cubits from wingtip to wingtip. The second cherub also measured 10 cubits, for the two cherubim were identical in size and shape. The height of each cherub was 10 cubits. He placed the cherubim inside the innermost room of the temple, with their wings spread out. The wing of one cherub touched one wall, while the wing of the other touched the other wall, and their wings touched each other in the middle of the room. He overlaid the cherubim with gold. On the walls all around the temple, in both the inner and outer rooms, he carved cherubim, palm trees, and open flowers. He also covered the floors of both the inner and outer rooms of the temple with gold. For the entrance to the inner sanctuary, he made doors out of olive wood that were 1/5 of the width of the sanctuary. And on the 2 olive wood doors, he carved cherubim, palm trees, and open flowers, and overlaid the cherubim and palm trees with hammered gold. In the same way, for the entrance to the main hall, he made door frames out of olive wood that were 1/4 of the width of the hall. He also made 2 doors out of juniper wood, each having 2 leaves that turned in sockets. He carved cherubim, palm trees, and open flowers on them, and overlaid them with gold hammered evenly over the carvings. And he built the inner courtyard of 3 courses of dressed stone, and 1 course of trimmed cedar beams. The foundation of the temple of the Lord was laid in the 4th year, in the month of Ziv. In the 11th year, in the month of Bul, the 8th month, the temple was finished in all its details according to its specifications. He had spent 7 years building. It took Solomon 13 years, however, to complete the construction of his palace. He built the palace of the Forest of Lebanon, 100 cubits long, 50 wide, and 30 high, with 4 rows of cedar columns supporting trimmed cedar beams. It was roofed with cedar above the beams that rested on the columns, 45 beams, 15 to a row. Its windows were placed high in sets of 3, facing each other. All the doorways had rectangular frames. They were in the front part in sets of 3, facing each other. He made a colonnade 50 cubits long and 30 wide. In front of it was a portico, and in front of that were pillars and an overhanging roof. He built the throne hall, the hall of justice where he was to judge, and he covered it with cedar from floor to ceiling. And the palace in which he was to live, set farther back, was similar in design. Solomon also made a palace like this hall for Pharaoh's daughter, whom he had married. All these structures, from the outside to the great courtyard, and from foundation to eaves, were made of blocks of high-grade stone cut to size and trimmed with a saw on their inner and outer faces. The foundations were laid with large stones of good quality, some measuring 10 cubits and some 8. Above were high-grade stones cut to size and cedar beams. The great courtyard was surrounded by a wall of 3 courses of dressed stone and 1 course of trimmed cedar beams, as was the inner courtyard of the temple of the Lord with its portico. King Solomon sent to Tyre and brought Huram, whose mother was a widow from the tribe of Naphtali, and whose father was from Tyre, and a skilled worker in bronze. Huram was filled with wisdom, with understanding, and with knowledge to do all kinds of bronze work. He came to King Solomon and did all the work assigned to him. He cast 2 bronze pillars, each 18 cubits high and 12 cubits in circumference. He also made 2 capitals of cast bronze to set on the tops of the pillars. Each capital was 5 cubits high. A network of interwoven chains adorned the capitals on top of the pillars, 7 for each capital. He made pomegranates in two rows, encircling each network to decorate the capitals on top of the pillars. He did the same for each capital. The capitals on top of the pillars in the portico were in the shape of lilies, 4 cubits high. On the capitals of both pillars, above the bowl-shaped part, next to the network, were the 200 pomegranates in rows all around. He erected the pillars at the portico of the temple. The pillar to the south he named Jachin, and the one to the north, Boaz. The capitals on top were in the shape of lilies. And so the work on the pillars was completed. He made the sea of cast metal, circular in shape, measuring 10 cubits from rim to rim and 5 cubits high. It took a line of 30 cubits to measure around it. Below the rim, gourds encircled it, 10 to a cubit. The gourds were cast in two rows in one piece with the sea. The sea stood on 12 bulls, 3 facing north, 3 facing west, 3 facing south, and 3 facing east. The sea rested on top of them, and their hindquarters were toward the center. It was a handbreadth in thickness, and its rim was like the rim of a cup, like a lily blossom. It held 2,000 baths. He also made 10 movable stands of bronze. Each was 4 cubits long, 4 wide, and 3 high. This is how the stands were made. They had side panels attached to uprights. On the panels between the uprights were lions, bulls, and cherubim, and on the uprights as well. Above and below the lions and bulls were wreaths of hammered work. Each stand had 4 bronze wheels with bronze axles, and each had a basin resting on 4 supports, cast with wreaths on each side. On the inside of the stand, there was an opening that had a circular frame 1 cubit deep. This opening was round, and with its base work, it measured 1.5 cubits. Around its opening, there was engraving. The panels of the stands were square, not round. The 4 wheels were under the panels, and the axles of the wheels were attached to the stand. The diameter of each wheel was 1.5 cubits. The wheels were made like chariot wheels. The axles, rims, spokes, and hubs were all of cast metal. Each stand had 4 handles, one on each corner, projecting from the stand. At the top of the stand, there was a circular band 0.5 cubit deep. The supports and panels were attached to the top of the stand. He engraved cherubim, lions, and palm trees on the surfaces of the supports and on the panels in every available space, with wreaths all around. This is the way he made the 10 stands. They were all cast in the same molds and were identical in size and shape. He then made 10 bronze basins, each holding 40 baths and measuring 4 cubits across, one basin to go on each of the 10 stands. He placed 5 of the stands on the south side of the temple and 5 on the north. He placed the sea on the south side, at the southeast corner of the temple. He also made the pots and shovels and sprinkling bowls. So Huram finished all the work he had undertaken for King Solomon in the temple of the Lord. The 2 pillars, the 2 bowl-shaped capitals on top of the pillars, the 2 sets of network decorating the 2 bowl-shaped capitals on top of the pillars, the 400 pomegranates for the 2 sets of network, 2 rows of pomegranates for each network decorating the bowl-shaped capitals on top of the pillars, the 10 stands with their 10 basins, the sea and the 12 bulls under it, the pots, shovels, and sprinkling bowls. All these objects that Huram made for King Solomon for the temple of the Lord were of burnished bronze. The king had them cast in clay molds in the plain of the Jordan between Succoth and Zarethan. Solomon left all these things unweighed because there were so many. The weight of the bronze was not determined. Solomon also made all the furnishings that were in the Lord's temple. The golden altar, the golden table on which was the bread of the presence, the lampstands of pure gold, 5 on the right and 5 on the left, in front of the inner sanctuary. the gold floral work and lamps and tongs, the pure gold basins, wick trimmers, sprinkling bowls, dishes and censers, and the gold sockets for the doors of the innermost room, the most holy place, and also for the doors of the main hall of the temple. When all the work King Solomon had done for the temple of the Lord was finished, he brought in the things his father David had dedicated, the silver and gold and the furnishings, and he placed them in the treasuries of the Lord's temple. Then King Solomon summoned into his presence at Jerusalem the elders of Israel, all the heads of the tribes and the chiefs of the Israelite families, to bring up the Ark of the Lord's Covenant from Zion, the city of David. All the Israelites came together to King Solomon at the time of the festival in the month of Ethanim, the seventh month. When all the elders of Israel had arrived, the priests took up the Ark, and they brought up the Ark of the Lord and the tent of meeting and all the sacred furnishings in it. The priests and Levites carried them up, and King Solomon and the entire assembly of Israel that had gathered about him were before the ark, sacrificing so many sheep and cattle that they could not be recorded or counted. The priests then brought the ark of the Lord's covenant to its place in the inner sanctuary of the temple, the most holy place, and put it beneath the wings of the cherubim. The cherubim spread their wings over the place of the ark and overshadowed the ark and its carrying poles. These poles were so long that their ends could be seen from the holy place in front of the inner sanctuary, but not from outside the holy place, and they are still there today. There was nothing in the ark except the two stone tablets that Moses had placed in it at Horeb, where the Lord made a covenant with the Israelites after they came out of Egypt. When the priests withdrew from the holy place, the cloud filled the temple of the Lord, and the priests could not perform their service because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled his temple. Then Solomon said,
"The Lord has said that he would dwell in a dark cloud. I have indeed built a magnificent temple for you, a place for you to dwell forever."
While the whole assembly of Israel was standing there, the king turned around and blessed them. Then he said,
"Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, who with his own hand has fulfilled what he promised with his own mouth to my father David. For he said, 'Since the day I brought my people Israel out of Egypt, I have not chosen a city in any tribe of Israel to have a temple built, that my name might be there. But I have chosen David to rule my people Israel.' My father David had it in his heart to build a temple for the name of the Lord, the God of Israel. But the Lord said to my father David, 'You did well to have it in your heart to build a temple for my name. Nevertheless, you are not the one to build the temple, but your son, who is your own flesh and blood, he is the one who will build the temple for my name.' The Lord has kept the promise he made. I have succeeded David, my father, and now I sit on the throne of Israel, just as the Lord promised, and I have built the temple for the name of the Lord, the God of Israel. I have provided a place there for the ark, in which is the covenant of the Lord that he made with our ancestors when he brought them out of Egypt."
Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in front of the whole assembly of Israel, spread out his hands toward heaven, and said,
"Lord, the God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth below. You who keep your covenant of love with your servants, who continue wholeheartedly in your way. You have kept your promise to your servant David, my father. With your mouth you have promised, and with your hand you have fulfilled it, as it is today. Now, Lord, the God of Israel, keep for your servant David, my father, the promises you made to him when you said,
you shall never fail to have a successor to sit before me on the throne of Israel. If only your descendants are careful in all they do to walk before me faithfully, as you have done. And now, God of Israel, let your word that you promised your servant David, my father, come true. But will God really dwell on earth? The heavens, even the highest heaven, cannot contain you. How much less this temple I have built? Yet give attention to your servant's prayer and his plea for mercy, Lord my God. Hear the cry and the prayer that your servant is praying in your presence this day. May your eyes be open toward this temple, night and day, this place of which you said, my name shall be there, so that you will hear the prayer your servant prays toward this place. Hear the supplication of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray toward this place. Hear from heaven, your dwelling place, and when you hear, forgive. When anyone wrongs their neighbor and is required to take an oath, and they come and swear the oath before your altar in this temple, then hear from heaven and act. Judge between your servants, condemning the guilty by bringing down on their heads what they have done, and vindicating the innocent by treating them in accordance with their innocence. When your people Israel have been defeated by an enemy because they have sinned against you, and when they turn back to you and give praise to your name, praying and making supplication to you in this temple, then hear from heaven and forgive the sin of your people Israel and bring them back to the land you gave to their ancestors. When the heavens are shut up and there is no rain because your people have sinned against you, and when they pray toward this place and give praise to your name and turn from their sin because you have afflicted them, then hear from heaven and forgive the sin of your servants, your people Israel. Teach them the right way to live and send rain on the land you gave your people for an inheritance. When famine or plague comes to the land, or blight or mildew, locusts or grasshoppers, or when an enemy besieges them in any of their cities, whatever disaster or disease may come, and when a prayer or plea is made by anyone among your people Israel, being aware of the afflictions of their own hearts and spreading out their hands toward this temple, then hear from heaven, your dwelling place. Forgive and act. Deal with everyone according to all they do. Since you know their hearts, for you alone know every human heart, so that they will fear you all the time they live in the land you gave our ancestors. As for the foreigners who do not belong to your people Israel, but have come from a distant land because of your name, for they will hear of your great name, and your mighty hand, and your outstretched arm. When they come and pray toward this temple, then hear from heaven, your dwelling place. Do whatever the foreigners ask of you, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your own people Israel, and may know that this house I have built bears your name. When your people go to war against their enemies, wherever you send them, and when they pray to the Lord toward the city you have chosen and the temple I have built for your name, then hear from heaven their prayer and their plea, and uphold their cause. When they sin against you, for there is no one who does not sin, and you become angry with them and give them over to their enemies, who take them captive to their own lands, far away or near, and if they have a change of heart in the land where they are held captive, and repent, and plead with you in the land of their captors, and say, we have sinned, we have done wrong, we have acted wickedly. And if they turn back to you with all their heart and soul in the land of their enemies who took them captive,
and pray to you toward the land you gave their ancestors, toward the city you have chosen and the temple I have built for your name, then from heaven, your dwelling place, hear their prayer and their plea, and uphold their cause, and forgive your people who have sinned against you. Forgive all the offenses they have committed against you, and cause their captors to show them mercy. For they are your people and your inheritance, whom you brought out of Egypt, out of that iron smelting furnace. May your eyes be open to your servant's plea, and to the plea of your people Israel, and may you listen to them whenever they cry out to you, for you singled them out from all the nations of the world to be your own inheritance, just as you declared through your servant Moses when you, Sovereign Lord, brought our ancestors out of Egypt.
When Solomon had finished all these prayers and supplications to the Lord, he rose from before the altar of the Lord, where he had been kneeling with his hands spread out toward heaven. He stood and blessed the whole assembly of Israel in a loud voice, saying,
Praise be to the Lord, who has given rest to his people Israel, just as he promised. Not one word has failed of all the good promises he gave through his servant Moses. May the Lord our God be with us, as he was with our ancestors. May he never leave us nor forsake us. May he turn our hearts to him, to walk in obedience to him, and keep the commands, decrees, and laws he gave our ancestors. And may these words of mine, which I have prayed before the Lord, be near to the Lord our God day and night, that he may uphold the cause of his servant and the cause of his people Israel, according to each day's need, so that all the peoples of the earth may know that the Lord is God, and that there is no other. And may your hearts be fully committed to the Lord our God, to live by his decrees and obey his commands, as at this time.
Then the king and all Israel with him offered sacrifices before the Lord. Solomon offered a sacrifice of fellowship offerings to the Lord: 22,000 cattle and 120,000 sheep and goats. So the king and all the Israelites dedicated the temple of the Lord. On that same day, the king consecrated the middle part of the courtyard in front of the temple of the Lord. And there he offered burnt offerings, grain offerings, and the fat of the fellowship offerings, because the bronze altar that stood before
inspired by the Bible Experience.
Thank you for joining us today, and we'll see you again next time.